Good evening. Well, the past 24 hours have seen quite a ripple in political circles as former Finance Minister Yashwant Sinha broke his silence on the economy and wrote a piece in the Indian Express that essentially tore the government apart on its economic policy, particularly the finance minister's handling of the situation, and has predicted that the economy may not even recover in time for the next Lok Sabha election. In the last 24 hours, we've seen intriguing politics being played out here in Delhi. We've also seen a rebuttal from Union Minister Jayant Sinha in a piece that he wrote for the Times of India this morning. He also happens to be Mr. Yashwant Sinha's son. Well, to talk about that and much, much more, we have the former Finance Minister, Mr. Yashwant Sinha, joining us on NDTV this evening. Mr. Sinha, thank you for speaking to us today. And let me begin by asking you, why you said that you needed to speak up now? That was the title of the piece, in fact, that you wrote yesterday morning. Why did you decide that this was the right moment to speak?
Nidhi, as you are aware, I had decided in 2014 that I will not contest the Lok Sabha elections. I opted out of electoral politics. For the last 3 years and a half, I have been trying to lead a quiet life in my corner. But I always held the view that I could not keep silent when issues of national importance arose. And that is why for the last year and a half or so, I involved myself in Jammu and Kashmir issue so that we could find some resolution of that long pending issue. But when I looked at a whole series of facts and figures with regard to the economy, and especially when the latest quarterly figure of growth, economic growth, were published for the first quarter of this financial year, then I felt very, very concerned, because for 6 quarters now, the growth rate of the economy has been going down. And we have reached a stage where it has gone as low as 5.7%, which is the lowest in 3 years. So I felt that there were certain points which I must bring to the notice of the people of this country in the national interest and the notice of the government, so that if the government felt it so, they could take corrective steps. It's entirely up to the government. Take note of what I have said. They have the option to deny everything. Mr. Jayant Sinha has written an article to which you referred, and I have seen that article. I'll only like to say that he is doing his dharma, I am doing my dharma.
But let me ask you a little bit more about what Jayant Sinha has written. He is, of course, a union minister, Mr. Sinha. He happens to be your son, and he begins his piece by saying that several articles have been recently written on the challenges facing the economy. Unfortunately, they draw sweeping conclusions from a narrow set of facts and miss the fundamental structural reforms that are transforming the economy. Are you saying you don't agree with this at all? And he's gone on to list what he thinks are the game changers, from GST, demonetization, digital payments, also, you know, making processes more transparent, more rule-based. Do you believe that these are not structural changes that are taking place?
My take, Nidhi, on this is very simple. The economy, as I have said, has been in a declining mode for 6 quarters now. When demonetization came on the 8th of November last year, the economy was already on a downward swing. This was hardly the right time for a massive disruption which the demonetization brought to the economy. Point number one. Point number two is, when demonetization was done, it was well known that government was working on the GST, and everyone who was familiar with the subject would have known that GST will be another big disruptor of the economy. So you have, these may be very good in the long term, I don't know, but the point is, the sequencing has been wrong. They have come in close succession of each other. One disruption had not ended when you disrupted the economy again, and the results are there for all of us to see. So whatever may be the merit of this in the long term, in the short term, they have caused a lot of disruption and a lot of pain.
Can I ask you what you then feel about the way the government and the BJP as a party the way it has been responding to the economic crisis? You've had Mr. Amit Shah who called it the decline of the GDP a technical issue, and that was repeated by party sources yesterday in response to your piece. Do you think there's a denial in the government about just how serious the situation is?
Yes, I think there is a denial, and you know, I have quoted from the SBI report, which clearly says that it is not a technical downturn that we are noticing. There are others who believe that this is going to stay for a while. It is not going to go away in a hurry. So I don't know what Mr. Amit Shah meant by saying it is technical. But it is not technical. It is real, and it is here to stay until we take corrective steps.
You also mentioned in your piece, Mr. Sinha, that you believe that what you were saying and what you're saying right now about the economy is something that is reflected in the sentiments of a large number of people, even in the BJP and elsewhere, who you say are not speaking up out of fear. Fear of whom? Fear of what?
Yes. There are members of the party at various levels. There are members of parliament. There are members of the state assembly who, whenever I have met them, interacted with them, this is the point that they have made, that things are not moving in the right direction, but they are not either allowed to raise these issues or they are afraid to raise these issues.
Why are they afraid? What are they afraid of?
No, they are afraid of the very simple fact, you know, just as a government employee looks forward to his promotion, and an MP and MLA looks forward to renomination. When the election comes, they hope to be renominated from their constituencies. And they are scared that, they are afraid that if they speak up, then that renomination will be denied to them. That will be a hammer blow, and therefore they don't want to go under it.
You've been particularly critical, though, of the finance minister, Mr. Arun Jaitley. You've talked about the multiple ministries that he has held charge of. Do you believe that the way things stand today in the economy is primarily his responsibility, or does the buck actually stop at the Prime Minister's doorstep because he is the captain of this team?
The buck stops at the Finance Minister. All my experience in government, especially of that ministry, would suggest that the Prime Minister, of course, is a participant in the decision-making process, but the decisions are prepared and are taken by the Finance Minister in consultation with the Prime Minister. So therefore, the Finance Minister, like the minister in any other line ministry, is directly responsible for his ministry and the functioning of that ministry. If things are going wrong, things are not going the right way, then clearly the responsibility will first lie on the Finance Minister.
If the picture of the economy is as grim as you've painted it, Mr. Sinha, and as have some economists, there are those who disagree, though, but if it is as grim as you say it is, do you think Mr. Jaitley should resign as Finance Minister? Would you be asking for his resignation?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that, you know, the steps should have been taken earlier. If they have not been taken earlier, they should be taken now. We should have a series of steps to ensure that the economy is put back on the right track.
What are the steps that you would recommend, Mr. Sinha? What are the three or four things that you would recommend for the government to do right now?
The three or four very important things which I'll recommend for the government is for everyone concerned to sit down and take a decision about the stalled projects. There are lakhs of crores of rupees involved in these projects which have not received all the clearances. So the government should sit down and decide immediately, maybe within the next 15 days, which are the projects which can go forward, which are the projects which must be closed. Then, you know, they should close those projects and push forward those projects which can be pushed forward. This will have a beneficial impact also on the bank NPAs. Then the NPAs of the banks have to be attended to. There is no reason why they should keep going every 6 months. The NPS problem has to be attended to. There are a number of steps which can be taken to stem the tide of rising NPAs. Banks must be enabled to finance private sector investment. Then where will that investment take place is also a guidance which the government should give. Obviously, the need in the economy today is to raise the demand for investment goods. You know, if investment takes place, the demand for investment goods will increase and the economy will start moving forward. In the wake of the investment demand will come consumption demand. Consumers will start consuming. So this is the benign cycle which can be put in motion if we take all these steps. Most importantly, the remedial measures necessary for improving the health of the banking sector. That is the most important issue in the economy today. Then you have many other steps which can be taken. As I said, you know, when we were in government, we started a whole lot of new projects. Construction sector, as I have said, is the biggest employer. Textile sector is a major employer. Agriculture, of course, is the most important employer. Now, these are sectors which are in distress. They should be remedied. So along with a macro approach, there should be a sectoral approach, and sector-wise, we should try and identify the problems and resolve them.
I just want to go back to Jayant Sinha's article for a moment, Mr. Sinha. And there, you know, he talks about, when he summarizes his piece, he says the structural reforms unleashed by the Modi government in the last 3 years constitute the third generation of reforms since 1991. And it essentially balances a better life for all Indians with the requirements of an advanced, sophisticated 21st century economy. Do you disagree with that completely?
No, I don't. I don't. They are structural reforms, but along with their questions of sequencing. Should demonetization have been done in November, knowing full well that GST was coming soon, or we should have waited? Should not have done demonetization at all, because I don't think we have achieved the results which we set out to achieve through demonetization. These are questions which remain. The point is, there are major steps which have been taken, including the bankruptcy code, but they don't solve all the problems. We'll have to take a large number of steps across the board, as I said, in order to shore up the economy. These three measures, GST, demonetization and bankruptcy code, alone will not do it. They have not led to much greater investment. Has demonetization resulted in greater private sector investment?
The BJP would argue,
GST
Mr.
has
Sinha,
been a disruptor.
Well, the BJP would argue, Mr. Sinha, that demonetization brought them at least a big political victory in UP, which is such a big state. So politically, it worked out really well.
There are times when something which is very good politically is not very good economically. And I am not looking at it from the political point of view at all. I have clearly said in that article that I have written that it was an unmitigated economic disaster. But whatever its results may be politically, that is a different issue. I am not going into that. But the point I am making is, economically, it was not the correct step to take at that point of time.
Mr. Sinha, let me though ask you a political question about why you chose to speak up at this point. There are many in the BJP who feel that, you know, you are a disgruntled senior leader. You had party leaders yesterday telling journalists that you and Mr. Arun Shori are frustrated, which is why you are speaking out at this time and saying these things. What would you say to that?
I'll say this, Nidhi, that this is the easiest and the cheapest accusation to make against anyone. I am disgruntled. What am I disgruntled about? I chose not to contest the 2014 election. You go and ask Mr. Rajnath Singh, who was the party president. I told him I don't want to contest the election. I want to remove myself from the electoral fray permanently. So I opted out of the election process. So, and for 3.5 years, if you are not a member of parliament, you can't be a minister. Is there a system in our country that you can be a minister without being a member of parliament? So what are these people saying who say, I'm frustrated? I'm not frustrated. I deliberately chose this path, but my removing myself from the electoral fray, my becoming quiet in party politics does not mean that I'll not speak on national issues. I will speak on national issues. That is the role that I can't deny myself.
But would you concede, Mr. Sinha, that you have a somewhat strained relationship with the Prime Minister? You've been trying to meet him, and it's now quite well known you've been trying to meet him for some time, isn't it? On Jammu and Kashmir, where you've been making initiatives, and trying to initiate some kind of a dialogue and a peace process. When was the last time you were able to have a meeting? Has he met you at all on Kashmir or anything else recently?
No, when I was in Kashmir in December last year, on my second visit, I felt that it was the right time to talk to the Prime Minister. And I asked for time from the Prime Minister's office. We are in September, almost 10 months have passed, and I'm still waiting for that appointment. It has not yet materialized. I am quite confident that I had some very worthwhile suggestions to make to the government on the Jammu and Kashmir issue, and if the government had listened to me, then the situation in Jammu and Kashmir would have been much better than it is today. Be that as it may, to those who say, why didn't I seek time from the Prime Minister or anybody else to go and make this suggestion instead of bringing them in the public domain, my answer is simple, because I found that those doors were shut for me. There was no entry, and therefore I had no option but to take recourse to the media to air my views.
Well, you're saying that the Prime Minister's doors are shut for you, which is why you felt the need to take recourse to the media. But can I ask you, Mr. Sinha, are you still with the BJP? Are you still a part of the BJP?
I also clarify that I am saying all this as a matter of fact, without any bitterness. As far as the BJP is concerned, I have generally been, keeping myself aloof from party activities. I have not participated in any major program of the party in the last 3.5 years. Nobody has asked me to either. And I did not also have the will or the wish to participate in those programs. But technically, I am still an active member of the party because I renewed my membership. I am still a member of the National Executive. I get invitations to attend those meetings, but I have not opted out of the party, and the party has not thrown me out. That's the situation at the moment.
Do you think that all of this, though, makes it a little awkward for Jayant Sinha, who is a union minister? Has it made things awkward between you and him? And do you think it could make things awkward for him and his position in the government?
My take on this, Nidhi, is this. It is not a father and son issue. It is not an issue between Jayant Sinha and me. If Jayant Sinha has written that article that he has written today in the Times of India out of his own sweet will, he is welcome to it. If he has been asked by somebody to write that article, then I'll say it's a cheap trick to try and pit my son in front of me, against me. It is not something which can be described as dignified.
What do you think? You think he wrote it on his own or that he was pressured to?
I don't know. I have not spoken to him. Someday when I speak to him, I'll try and find out. But I've been meeting journalists throughout the day, especially TV journalists, and they all come and tell me that he was made to write this article.
Well, that's quite something. Well, Mr. Sinha, before I let you go, I'll just ask you once again, the red flag that you raised in the article about the economy, and you really don't believe that things can turn around by 2019. You believe that this is going to be a long haul, even an economic turnaround will take much more time.
You know, forget what I said. Yesterday, I read in the newspapers that A.M. Nayak, who used to be the CEO or chairman of L&T, that famous construction company, he has said, we'll have to wait for 2 years before the economy turns around. You know, so the point I'm making is, and I made it in the article also, that things don't happen in a hurry as far as the economic turnaround is concerned, one has to really work very hard, take a number of steps to make the economy turn around. And I think that even if we start taking those steps now, it is not going to produce the results we want by the time the next Lok Sabha elections are upon us.
All right, Mr. Sinha, well, you've certainly been blunt. You've not minced any words there in what you feel is a warning that should be heeded to, that should be listened to. Maybe the government is taking your feedback in somewhere, even though they don't seem to be too pleased about it in general. But thank you very much, Mr. Sinha.
I hope they do.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sinha, for talking to us today. Thank you. Well, that was former Finance Minister Mr. Yashwant Sinha there giving his warning of the state of the economy. But is that really the case? Is it that the economy is in such dire trouble that it will not recover by 2019, as Mr. Sinha says, or is there hope of a turnaround even some months down the line? Joining us on the panel tonight, we have Jay Panda, who has written a piece on this, in fact, just yesterday. We'll be talking to him about that. We have Mr. Gurcharan Das here in the studio with us. Professor Arun Kumar is back with us, and Jay V. Shergill of the Congress Party also joining us tonight. Jay, let me take this to you first. What did you think of Yashwant Sinha's warning on the economy? How are you first looking at this particular row that has broken out in the last couple of days over his comments, his op-ed, and now his interviews?
Well, that's for the BJP and their internal dynamics to gauge. Now, but I don't share Mr. Sinha's pessimism to that extent. So in my piece, what I've written is that, of course, demonetization and GST has caused the economy to slow down. But that was expected. When demonetization happened, there were a lot of predictions of whether the effect would last for one or two quarters or longer than that. And GST is, of course, the single biggest economic reform in this country in the last 70 years. And it's a very structural change. And that, too, was predicted to have initial teething troubles. But to say that the economy has tanked, we still have 5.7% growth rate. And that would be considered healthy in many parts of the world. But as far as India is concerned, we must, of course, be targeting 8% plus because we have a lot of catching up to do. My point about demonetization was that you can't have your cake and eat it too and argue that it did not affect black money, but somehow the economy did go down. It did affect black money. You can see that in the real estate sector. You can see that in the for-profit education sector. And GST's teething troubles are well known with the online clogging and all of that. But if these can be sorted out in the coming quarter, then I'm optimistic that within the next two or three quarters, we are going to see a much healthier economy.
I think that really is key, as you said, Jay. If this can be sorted out in the coming quarter, then perhaps things can turn around. Professor Arun Kumar, do you think it's possible to sort these issues out in the next quarter? We're not far from that.
Yeah. So, my take is that the real growth of the economy at the moment is probably not more than 1 or 2%. Because it's the unorganized
sector. 1 or 2%.
Yes.
So that's even lower than the 3.7% that Yashwant Sinha spoke
about. And the reason is that the unorganized sector is the one that got hit very hard. And that data comes with a time lag of 1 or 2 years. That data is not structured into this 5.7% or 3.7%. And because that was hit, according to surveys during demonetization, like the State Bank of India, Punjab, Haryana, Delhi Chamber of Commerce and Industry, etc., 60 to 80% was hit. So if that it was the large hit, then the rate of growth is much lower. Second point is that credit offtake, which was already very low in October 2016, fell further and became a record low in 60 years. And in July, August, the credit offtake fell to negative, which has never happened before in India, which suggests that people are not demanding credit from the banks, and therefore they're not investing, and the demand is low. Third is capacity utilization data from RBI shows that capacity utilization had dropped below 70%. In that period, it was 70 to 75%, and because of demand fall, it has fallen further below. And when capacity utilization goes down, investment rate goes down. And investment in the December quarter of last year was roughly half of what it was in 2015. And when capacity utilization is low, investment is low, demand is low, then it's a prolonged impact, because when investment is down, growth rate is low.
So, in other words, the next quarter ain't
so,
fixing it.
So, you know, what will happen is, because there's a downward trend, there can be fluctuations. It might pick up because of the low base earlier, but it doesn't mean that the trend is not going down. The trend is going down, and we have to plan on the basis of the actual data rather than this hypothetical data of 5.7%, which is based on what the organized sector and what the corporate sector.
Okay, so let me ask Gurcharan Das, your take on this. Is this hypothetical data? Are some people being too alarmist, as Jay Panda seems to suggest? Is there? Do you have a more nuanced take on this? What do you think?
Yeah, well, I think that Yashwant Sinha has been overly pessimistic, and so my friend here, Arun Kumar on the left. The Indian economy actually has some of the best structural features for high growth, and it's still not too late. One of the good points, frankly, that Yashwant Sinha did make is that we've had a part-time finance minister. Finance ministry is not a part-time job. He's had to have this portfolio, that portfolio. He's run up to four portfolios. What you really need, there's a lovely word in yoga called ekagrata, means single-pointedness. Now, if I were the prime minister, I promised the country jobs. I would have had 1,000 people wake up every morning working precisely on that. And it can be done. I mean, just give you one example. And this is not the debate
but
about...
The unemployment numbers are also a big concern.
I know, but the reality is that we have the largest employing sector in any country, especially in India, is housing. And one of the excellent programs that this government has put in place is a Housing for All project, and they have created 8 potential PPP models to work that as an infrastructure, to go about it as infrastructure. Now, if one actually goes and implements that, from that you can have a very major difference. Now, this is just one example.
But let me take what you're saying to Jayveed, that obviously for the Congress, this would be very much a political issue, and as an opposition party, obviously you will latch on to the things that are not quite working right. But just comment on that. I mean, the fact is that economists, I mean, here two of them sitting next to you, are quite divided on what the state of the economy actually is and how long this slowdown is going to last.
Nidhi, on your first point, actually, BJP has reduced a serious economic crisis into a political battle between a father and son, and that's political chicanery at its worst. Today, with due respect, Mr. Jayant Sinha, shunted from the finance ministry by the prime minister himself, gives a reply on serious economic issues. It shows this is pure political. BJP, as usual, wants to shoot the messenger, but they can't bury the truth. Now, let's come to the content of this article and your question of sorted. I read his article. The word will appears 8 times in articles. Mr. Yashwant Sinha is saying there is no water in the tap. Mr. Jayant Sinha is saying, don't worry, I'll find water on Mars. That is the crux of this. He's talking about agricultural distress. He's talking about aero connectivity. There comes the next point, sorting out. The government's consistency in living in a perpetual denial mode, rejecting and rebutting economic critiques with victimization or denial doesn't augur well with the economy. That is the real problem. Now, I heard they are very senior to me. The common man doesn't understand the number jugglery, these fancy terms, GDP. For them, the true barometer is price of the petrol, vegetables, employment, the daily cost of life is very high.